completed. Brethren, I received the Lord, but I also handed on to you that the Lord Jesus, on the night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and having given thanks, broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after the supper, he took the cup, saying, "This is the cup of the New Testament, of the new covenant, in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it, as a remembrance of me." Every time, then, that you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the death of the Lord until he comes. So whoever drinks or eats this bread and drinks the cup of the Lord unworthily will have to answer for the body and blood of the Lord. A man should first examine himself. Only then shall he eat the bread and drink of the cup. For he who eats and drinks without recognizing the body eats and drinks a judgment against himself. This is the word of the Lord.
Father, as you sent me into the world, I have sent them into the world, and for their sake I consecrate myself so that they too may be consecrated in truth. I pray not only for these, but for those also who through their words will believe in me. May they all be one. Father, may they be one in us as you are in me and I am in you, so that the world may believe it was you who sent me. I have given them the glory you gave to me, that they may be one as we are one. With me and them and you and me, may they be so completely one that the world will realize that it was you who sent me, and that I have loved them as much as you loved me. These are the words of this evening's Holy Gospel. I am flabbergasted. When Father Lerczak, the pastor, asked me to preach, I gladly accepted any time to come back to St. Stanislaus. But I never realized that there would be a crowd like this. On second thought, I kind of envied Father Lerczak. Maybe next time around I'll fight a little more for St. Stan's. It's good to be back here, believe me. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen.
As some of you may know, I am again an administrator. This time of a church in Frankenmuth, Blessed Trinity. All of you probably realize that this community is largely a Lutheran community, about 90 to 95% Lutheran. 10 or even 5 years ago, it seemed unthinkable or impossible to have a Catholic church in Frankenmuth. But in 1967, the Blessed Trinity Mission was established with about 30 families. Now, presently, it has about 100 families. And in 1968, a beautiful piece of property adjacent to the garden, Rose Garden in Frankenmuth, was purchased from 3 Lutheran families. Someday, no doubt, there will be a beautiful church overlooking the park in Frankenmuth, a Catholic church. Presently, because we do not have our own church building, Mass is being offered at the Methodist Church, and on Saturday mornings in the Lutheran chapel at the convalescent home. There have been, and there will be, numerous interfaith marriages taking place in Frankenmuth, where both myself and the minister participate. The spirit of ecumenism and unity is certainly at work in Frankenmuth in this day and age. However, this is only one very small step towards unity. This is one small example of what is happening throughout the entire diocese, throughout the entire world. In this connection, the point I would like to stress this evening is this. Before we can possibly achieve a real and lasting unity among other churches, we must strive at the same time for unity and oneness among ourselves. That is, unity between myself and fellow man, unity between myself and God. The question arises, how? How are we to establish this oneness in all of these areas? I believe, and it can be accomplished through our constant efforts and through faith, trust, and confidence in Christ in the Eucharist, in the sacrament of unity, in the sacrament of oneness. At this point, you may say to yourselves that it is next to impossible for us to achieve unity among ourselves, let alone among other Protestant churches. No doubt it seems like a difficult task, but you may recall the beautiful ideals that Christ presented to us in the form of the Beatitudes. Blessed are they who hunger and thirst for holiness. They shall have their fill. Blessed are they who show mercy. Mercy shall be theirs. Blessed to the peacemakers. they shall be called sons of God. These ideals are no doubt certainly radical and difficult ones to accomplish. But Christ demanded that we turn the other cheek, walk the extra mile, give to everyone who asks, imitate the lilies of the field, pluck out an eye or cut off a hand which would separate man from God. These radical ideals or demands of Christ are no doubt difficult, just as his request or his hope that we be one as he and his heavenly Father are one. This may seem next to impossible to fulfill. Therefore, with that in mind, we may all agree that Jesus was indeed a great teacher, a man who by word and example invited us to a life of dedication, of love, and generosity. But we say to ourselves, he did not, of course, expect to be taken seriously. He did not really intend that all of his followers practice those virtues which he said would merit congratulations. This is a shrewd way of disposing of Jesus of Nazareth. Praise him mightily and say, of course, we can't be so impractical as to think that he really expected us to take him seriously. Indeed, it would have been much better for all concerned if Jesus had never spoken about these ideals or radical demands, because there are some people who insist that they must be taken seriously, that we do turn the other cheek, walk the extra mile, give to everyone who asks, and be one as Christ and his heavenly Father are one. It is true that a follower of Christ certainly will never fully observe or accomplish these ideals. We will constantly fall short. Nevertheless, this is a tremendous indication that we are in constant need of God's saving and loving mercy. The hope of the Christian rests only in God's mercy and love and nothing else. The security for the followers of Christ, that is for us, lies in our hope and his mercy and his love. And if there is one place where we can find that mercy, that love, that encouragement and strength to live up to these ideals and these wishes of Christ and of being one with God as Christ is with his Father, it is in the Eucharist. Oh yes, we may frequently fall short of these demands of Christ, but we cannot become discouraged. We cannot give up. There must be a constant striving, a trying, a plodding on. Always mindful of Christ's words. Come to me, all of you who are burdened, who are discouraged, who are anxious, and I will give you strength. I will give you the bread of life. I will give you my body and my blood. You have gathered here these last 3 days for this special occasion, for this beautiful occasion, to praise Christ, to thank him, and to ask him for the many needs that are so important in your lives. You do this every time you participate in the Eucharist. I certainly hope and pray that these last 3 days have given you that added encouragement and hope to carry on, and that you will continue to stride on, no matter what the obstacles are, to strive on towards that ideal of unity. Unity among yourselves, unity with God, unity with all men. Remember, in order to help you observe and fulfill the wishes and ideals of Christ, you have Christ in the Eucharist, and you have each other. God bless you and love you always. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Father.